Hola, good morning, friends. This is Dr. Pepe speaking. And welcome to the webinar. It's a first for me, so I hope you will be patient. I have chosen the title of Mediastinal Fat, my friend, because I want to emphasize the role of mediastinal fat in discovering diseases of the mediastinum and excluding them too. And this lecture, this webinar, will be interactive. And for that reason, I'm going to ask you to answer the questions that will be provided by the system. And without further ado, I'm going to show you the case number one. That is the case that was presented at the diploma last Monday. And those are radiographs. After that, you can answer the questions. Okay. More or less, 5 seconds have passed. 6, 7, 8, now. Okay, now I'll send you the questions. You can answer then. Don't take too much time. Don't be afraid. This is anonymous. Okay, let's see the answers. Okay, the majority of you, very good, excellent, excellent. Any of the above, okay. Because that this emphasizes my point that, this thing moves too fast for me, okay. Emphasizes my point that fat cannot be distinguished from soft tissues in the mediastinum. So you already knew the point. I'm very proud of you. On the right, you will see a CT, coronal reconstruction. And you see that the mass is completely fatty, is fat. And the correct answer is a lipoma. But with the plain film, your answer should be any of the above. So proud of you. First teaching point. You cannot separate fat from the soft tissues of the mediastinum in the plain film. Second, and very important teaching point, CT is the best way of discovering fat in the mediastinum. As I said, fat is very important. I'm going to tell you why. It's a mediastinal lipoma. Because I have divided the usefulness of CT on fatty lesions into three groups. First, helps to exclude relevant pathology because mediastinal fat, normal mediastinal fat, is ubiquitous and may simulate any type of pathology. Second, the discovery of mediastinal fat within a tumor in the mediastinum allows to narrow the differential diagnosis because only 5 or 6 tumors have fat inside. And third, the CT discovers complications of mediastinal conditions containing fat. Let's see, the first point, mediastinal fat simulating disease. Here you have an asymptomatic patient with an abnormal chest X-ray. And if you look at it, you see widening of the right mediastinum here, and also an apparently enlarged right hilum. Normally, when you see that, your first thought is a carcinoma of the lung affecting the hilum and the mediastinum. But when we do the coronal CT, you see that all the shadow is caused only by mediastinal fat. So that's one of the reasons for doing a CT, and that's one of the reasons why fat is helping us to exclude disease. Another similar case, this one is more subtle. If you look at this film, many of you may call it normal. If you look carefully, the patient has a thickened paratracheal line, and this is abnormal. Paratracheal line should be no wider than 3 or 4 millimeters, and this one is almost 1 centimeter wide. And the first possibility by far are lymph nodes in that side. But doing the CT, you discover that there are no lymph nodes there. All you see are mediastinal fat, rendering the study very useful and excluding any pathology, and the patient can go home very, very happy. Okay. Again, I want to repeat. Mediastinal fat can simulate the disease of the mediastinum, and CT is a method of choice to exclude any pathology. Okay, let's go now to case number two. He's a 60-year-old man with moderate dysphagia. Look at it, and I imagine you see what I'm seeing, that the patient has a middle-lower mediastinal mass. Okay, I guess you already saw that. And the differential diagnosis is very easy because 95% of this patient will have a hiatus hernia. Okay, so you can do a variant swallow. I don't know why, but in this patient, a CT was done. And there you have the CT. And you see that the patient has a fatty mass in that location. I'm showing you the coronal and sagittal reconstructions. And I'm offering you four diagnoses. Is this a lipoma or a liposarcoma or a lipoblastoma or none of the above? Look at the case carefully and think, because the answer, I don't know if can be provided, but you can choose one of the possibilities if you think. Okay, 10 more seconds. Look at the case, because I want to make up your mind. I know 10 seconds is not too much, but that's about the time that you will have when you are taking the examination. So, okay, now you can vote. I'll send you the. Okay. Four options and only one is right. Now I can see you are voting with more enthusiasm. And see, we finish. Well, we have a 90% participation, so I guess we can see the. Okay. Okay. Good. You don't need a webinar because you are right. Most of you, more than half, made the right decision. The correct answer is none of the above. It's not a lipoma, it's not a liposarcoma, it's not a lipoblastoma. It is this. It's an omental hernia. When you look at this, you see a very wide esophageal hiatus, and the abdominal hernia is going through the hiatus and herniating into the chest. Okay, so the diagnosis is omental hernia. What is the reason for this case? Because I want you to know and to think and to remember that when a mediastinal mass, a low mediastinal mass, is in the lower mediastinum, always, always think that it may come from below. It may be a diaphragmatic hernia because they are common. They may be fatty or not, but always think and exclude a diaphragmatic hernia, okay? You know, the most common hernias are three. The anterior ones are Morganis, in the middle, hiatus, and posterior, Bochladex. So you have to be aware of that and consider this possibility in any patient with the lower mediastinal mass. And you have to exclude that, which is very easy with a CT, of course. All you have to do is a reconstruction. For example, this case, the patient in 2017 has a typical pericardial fat pad on the right side, which is okay, we see that every day. It said that in the previous film, taken 5 years earlier, fat was not present. You don't see any fat here. So a CT was done. We confirm that the mass there is fatty, so it could be a hernia. It said that when we do the reconstruction, we see that the patient has a Morgagni hernia. You can see in the sagittal reconstruction the hole in the diaphragm and how an abdominal vessel is crossing, certifying that what we are seeing here is a Morgagni hernia because it's taking the vessels with it. Okay, so Morgagni hernia is the second possibility of the lower anterior mediastinal mass. And here we have another case related to hernia too. This one is a pre-op radiograph for, seen last year, patient for knee surgery, and it was discovered this nodule in the lower lung. And obviously, you consider that that might be a carcinoma, probably the best possibility. What we do is what we always do as radiologists, look for previous films. And there you have the previous film, 2012, and there you see the mass. They said that it's a little bit smaller. Well, it hasn't grown up too much in 5 years, but still it's worrisome. So we do a CT. What will we see? We see that this is a Bochladek hernia. We see here the gap in the diaphragm and the herniated fat from the abdomen, a posterior fat, demonstrating that this one is a Bochladek hernia. Conclusion, repeat again, always when you have a lower mediastinal mass, consider they may come from below, maybe a hernia, either with or without fat, but you have to exclude that with reconstruction. Okay, that's a good teaching point, and you have to remember it. Okay, I don't know if I'm going too fast, but you will tell me. Case number three. This is a 56-year-old woman with vague pain in the right hemithorax. This is a case that was lent to me by Theresa McLeod from the Mass General. And what you see is that the patient has a mass in the lower lung. You don't know where it's coming from. Has a contact here with the chest wall. Also has contact in the mediastinum there. And of course, it's contacting the diaphragm. So what you do when you find that? Do a CT, of course. And the CT was done, and CT demonstrated the mass, which is here in the periphery, there, adjacent to the liver, but probably is outside the liver, kind of people for sure. What about the density of the fat? Well, it's heterogeneous, but has the mass, I'm sorry. The density of the mass is heterogeneous and has fat and sort of a dirty fat here. There's anything there and has vessels inside. And when we do a PET, it has a high SUV. It enhances markedly after the injection of the isotope. Okay. With this information, I offer you four diagnoses. One, is a diaphragmatic hernia, 2, hibernoma, 3, liposarcoma, or 4, any one of them. Okay, now look at this, consider what I said, and choose the answer that is more likely in view of the radiographic findings. Okay, something happened. We are not still ready to send you the answers because there are some problems. But in the meantime, yeah, okay. Answer, okay. Select your answers. Diaphragmatic hernia, hibernoma, liposarcoma, or any of them. No, you are fast. That means either you don't know what it is or you are very knowledgeable. Okay. Let's see the answer. Good. This time you are wrong. And I'm glad because this offers me an opportunity to teach you something. The majority of you call it a liposarcoma, 71. And I think this is wrong, and I'll explain you why. Four said a diaphragmatic hernia. I don't think a diaphragmatic hernia will be a good possibility because they are pure fat, and this is sort of a dirty fat. Liposarcoma will be a good possibility unless you know what I'm going to explain to you. On any of the above, well, it's reasonable. Okay, well, the answer is hibernoma. And I don't know if you know what the hibernoma is, but the findings of this case are typical of hibernoma. The hibernoma is a benign soft tissue tumor, which is composed of brown fat, which is a fat that you know that is a very energetic fat, and is a fat that animals save for hibernating, and that explains the name of hibernoma. Most of them occur in the extremity, but about 10% are intrathoracic, and the findings in the CT are very typical. It's a sort of dirty fat attenuation. It looks like a spotted fat. It's a little bit denser than the normal fat. And then if you do a PET CT or just a PET, the SUV is very high because this fat is very energetic, as I said before, and the uptake of the isotopes is avid. However, remember, and I don't know if you knew that liposarcoma don't have a high SUV. It is low to intermediate. So in this case, it was not a likely diagnosis. This is then a hibernoma. If you didn't know what it was, now you know, and occasionally you are going to see one. I'm going to show you this hibernoma. As I said, I borrowed from Dr. McLeod, but I have my own hibernoma. I have seen only two, this one and the previous one. And this I saw a few days ago. A few years ago. And this is a patient with apparent pericardial fat pad here. But when we did the CT, there you have, she said, it's fatty, but it is a sort of dirty fat. It's not as dense as the muscle. And he has a lot of vessels, see? And that should make you think of hibernoma. We did the CT. The fat is more obvious here. But again, it's a little bit more dirty. Has vessels, and if you compare that with the abdominal fat, it is more opaque. And this is, again, typical of hibernoma. And the patient was operated on, and the diagnosis was proved. Okay? Remember that. Probably you are going to see perhaps one or two hibernomas in your life, but I want you, when you see one, to recognize it. Okay? And let's go to the mediastinal tumors with fat. We already mentioned the hibernoma, but as I said, finding fat within a mediastinal tumor narrows down the mediastinal, the differential diagnosis tremendously. Most of them are going to be number one or number two of the teratoma family, the germ-cell tumors. Either benign teratoma, which is more common, or a malignant teratoma, which is less common. About 80% of benign teratomas have fat. Malignants, a little bit less, a little bit of half of them, about 40%. All the others are much more rare. Lipomas, you have seen one, and they are unusual. Hibernoma, you already know. Thymolipoma is a tumor I would like to talk later on. And lipoblastoma is very unusual in adults. I had never seen one, and mostly occurs in children. And it's very rare in the chest, although it may happen. So, again, emphasizing the point, if in an adult person you find a tumor with fat inside, your differential diagnosis is reduced to 5 possibilities with a germinal tumor as the first possibility by far, okay? Let's see a few examples. This case, I want to show it because it's one of my first cases. You see the date here is from 1983. is a 16-year-old girl who came with the anterior mediastinal mass. Of course, you cannot tell much about it. But at that time, we just got our first Siemens CT with a 4 seconds cut, a slice. And there you have a beautiful slice, a very well-defined tumor with fat inside and a tooth. So the diagnosis of teratoma is inescapable. And there you have the specimen. You see the hair in the teratoma, sorry. And you see the fat too. The tooth is not seen in this case, okay? So, excellent diagnosis made because we have encapsulated tumor with fat, which is a hallmark of benign teratomas. Sometimes malignant teratomas occur. Here you have a 27-year-old man with fever and malaise and has a large mediastinal mass anterior. You can see that in the lateral view. And I guess probably my first diagnosis would be lymphoma because it's a most frequent tumor with symptoms in the anterior mediastinum. However, when we do the CT, what will we see? The first thing that we see is fat in several areas. It's not too obvious. These areas have fat density, and that's a hallmark of a germinal tumor. Considering the clinical history, probably the diagnosis is a malignant teratoma, which happened after the biopsy. Okay. Another teaching point in this case is that the patient has calcifications here and there, and that practically excludes lymphoma because they never calcified before treatment. After treatment, yes, they do. Okay, good. And I want to spend a few minutes talking about an unusual tumor, but the tumor that I have seen not very often, but I've seen at least a dozen of those. It's a tumor which in the plain film simulates cardiomegaly, see? The patient is an asymptomatic patient with an apparently beat heart on the AP and not so much in the lateral. But the clue here is that the patient is asymptomatic. When you see that, this patient cannot have a cardiomegaly of this size or a pericardial effusion without any symptoms. So your first possibility then is a tumor that is wrapping around the heart, simulating cardiomegaly. It's a soft tumor because it's composed mainly of fat. The lateral view also is very helpful because this tumor can come from above and obliterates the anterior clear space and does not displace the heart posteriorly. What we are looking at this, what we're looking here is a thymolipoma. It's a thymic tumor which has a fat component, that's the part, the lipoma part, and thymic part, which is the solid part, the solid tissue that you see within the tumor, okay? This is a typical appearance of the thymolipoma that you see in the CT, and is practically diagnostic. And you see the heart is not affected at all because it's a very soft tumor. But you can, as I said, you can make the diagnosis, or you can suggest the diagnosis in the plain film. And let me show you this case that I saw in 1974. We didn't have CT at that time. And at that time, I moved to another hospital. And when I went there, they presented me this case. And they told me what it is. And of course, I didn't know what it was. But I asked if the patient was symptomatic. And they told me the patient was not. And it was a thymolipoma. I saw a large mass there, simulating, I don't know, a large heart or a pleural effusion. And then in the lateral view, there was affectation, occupation of the anterior clear space, and the heart was not displaced posteriorly because I did a barium swallow and see that the esophagus is not displaced. So with that, I dared to make the diagnosis on the brain film of thymolipoma, and that's what they found at surgery. As you can imagine, my credit at the hospital increased tremendously after this diagnosis. Okay. I hope you are not tired. I don't know how much time do we've been. About 25 minutes. Okay, we'll finish 10, no more than 15 minutes more. Okay, this is an interesting case, and I hope it will teach you something. Case 4. This is a middle-aged man, about 50 or 55, who came to the emergency room with acute left chest pain, and the chest was unremarkable. I mean, the patient has plate-like atelectasy at the bases, small pleural effusion on the left side, but nothing remarkable other than that. Then those findings are very inspecific. So he came back after 3 days and see what happens. The patient now has developed a mass there in the lower lung zone, there, an anterior mass that was not present in the previous study. Okay, so I'm not going to ask you to make the diagnosis with this, but I'm going to give you more information. I'm going to give you a CT and an MRI. And the CT, just to help you, you see an extra pulmonary lesion there with dirty fat inside, more obvious here in the sagittal reconstruction. And the MRI, you can see that the mass is fatty, obviously. Compare that with the abdominal fat. Okay, with these findings, I want to give you 4 diagnoses. One, is this a diaphragmatic hernia? Is it a hibernoma? It will be another one. It will be an epipericardial fat. And 4, don't know, and please tell me, which probably is the way you are thinking now. Okay, look at it for 5-10 seconds. And make up your mind. It's an easy case when you know the entity, but then. Okay. Now you can vote. Oh yeah, you're voting very fast. Okay, good. I like that. Now we're already on 50%. Go, go, go. We are 80%. We need 90. No? Okay. I 20% cowards. Okay. Let's go. Okay. Oh, 30% don't know. Tell, please. Very good. You are very, very honest. 20% diaphragmatic hernia. Very good. Hibernoma, 13%. And epipericardial fat, 37%. And this is the correct diagnosis. Epipericardial fat. Okay. Let's go to the there. Oh, okay. The diagnosis is epipericardial fat necrosis. And 37% for you knew the, about a third knew the diagnosis or knew the entity. About 60% didn't. That's very important because I think it's a very common entity. Oh, by the way, those of you that mentioned diaphragmatic hernia, you forgot to notice that the hernia needs a hiatus, needs a perforation, and here the diaphragm is completely normal, and also in the diaphragm, I'm sorry, in the MRI. So, of course, I could have been eaten that, but then I don't think that's correct. Hibernoma is not a good diagnosis because hibernomas don't happen in 3 days, and this mass was not present there. So this is epipericardial fat necrosis, which is a pathology that we described in 2005. Was initially described in 1957, and there were only 20 cases found until 2005, only 4 with CT, and all of them were diagnosed after operation. The etiology is a torsion and infarct, supposed etiology, torsion and infarct of the epipericardial fat. Epipericardial because it's outside the pericardium, it's more mediastinal fat, really. The clinical findings are acute chest pain and paracardiac opacity on the chest radiograph, either on the right or the left, and the diagnosis is made by CT, because then it shows encapsulated epipericardial fat, with the capsule around, dirty fat because of edema and necrosis. And important that the diagnosis is made with follow-up of the fat. We describe those two cases, the anterior and the next I'm going to show you, in an article in AJR in November 2005. And this is a second case. We saw this 52-year-old woman with two episodes of acute chest pain and a paracardiac opacity here, which is completely inspecific. But when we did CT, what we see? We see the typical findings of epipericardial fat. So, encapsulated fat there with a thick capsule, and then dirty fat inside it. And at that time, we didn't know the entity. We discovered the entity afterwards. But we have an epiphany. When we saw that, the thing looked like appendicitis, epiploic appendicitis of the abdomen. So then we thought this is a sort of epiploic appendicitis of the fat. And with this, we went to the clinical fellows and we said, we think this is infarcted fat. Please do not operate on the patient because this is really infarcted. Probably it will shrink down and disappear. And they pay attention to us. And this is the initial film with the opacity in the chest and the fat, epipericardial fat infarcted. And this is 6 weeks later. The opacity has disappeared and the fat, the epipericardial necrosis has shrunk, confirming the diagnosis. Since that time, since we published that, there are many reports of the epipericardial fat. I think it's a very common occurrence and should be included in the differential diagnosis of acute chest pain. We have collected many cases since that time, but we are not collecting them anymore. The thing I want to tell you, we have seen 4 cases of epipericardial fat with normal chest. So now we know that the chest don't have to be abnormal to make the diagnosis. And you need ACT to confirm it. And then this is not going to change because you are going to see the epipericardial fat necrosis with the typical appearance, thickened capsule, dirty fat, and then 5 weeks later has disappeared completely, okay? Again, this is a normal, it's a common occurrence in my opinion, and you have to be aware of that. I'm talking to the 60% of people that didn't suggest this diagnosis. If you are alert, I assure you that in the next 6 months, some of you are going to see a case, okay? Now, the last case, and we will finish, case number 5. This is a 35-year-old male with calf and malaise. And you see he has an abnormal chest. Let me help you with the semiology. Has an apparent mediastinal mass, but also has some lung disease adjacent to it. Okay, we are going to do a CT, obviously. There's the CT. Now, you know it's a mass there. There it is, with fat inside, well-defined, okay. And I mentioned before, the well-defined mass with the fat inside has a specific diagnosis. It said that a little bit lower down, the mass has adjacent disease in the lung, okay? And with this information, you have all the information you need. I'm giving you 4 possibilities. Is this a benign teratoma? Is this a malignant teratoma? Is it liposarcoma? Or you want to go home? Well, you are already home, I imagine, or working. But I think you probably are tired, and I promise we are finishing already. Look at it, make up your mind, think, and I hope I can teach you something new. Okay. Now, okay, you're fast. My assistant is very fast. Benign, malignant, lipo, want to go home. Yo, I want to go home. How much? 60%. On 60% now? Come on, hurry up. We have to see the World Series. I want to see Portugal. And then I want to see Spain tonight. Okay? Now we have the results. Very good. Want to? Nobody want to go home? Very good. I feel flattered. Okay, I'm not giving away any DVDs this time, anyhow. Benign teratoma, 33%, okay, because it just looks like a benign teratoma. Malignant teratoma because it has invasion of the adjacent lung, very good. Liposarcoma, 22% possibility. I must tell you that I had never seen a liposarcoma of the lung, although it happens. Oh, I'm sorry, of the mediastinal, because it may happen, but that's a possibility. Well, the answer is mature teratoma with chemical pneumonitis. And I'm glad because you didn't know this entity, because this time most of you swinged to our malignant lesion because it was lung affectation. The thing is, the benign or mature teratomas, they have fat inside, as I said before, and at body temperature, many times this fat is liquid, liquefies, and since it's a liquid, it moves through the capsule of the lung, of the tumor, seeps through the capsule, invades the lung, and the fat is irritating and causes chemical pneumonitis. Something I want you to know, because it's not common. I have seen this case and another one I'll show you later, but it happens. And there are many reports in the literature of normal or benign teratomas rupturing. Okay, so you have to know that and do not make the wrong diagnosis of malignant lesion. Sometimes the patient have trichoptysis, which is spitting up the hair. Sometimes the hair is spat because the teratoma has invaded the lung. And that's a symptom which is a pathognomonic of broken teratoma. Okay. And I want to show you the last case, because I saw this case 1 month ago. And this case was given to me by my friend Eva Castagné, former disciple. And when I told her about the ruptured teratoma, he said, I just saw a similar case, and there it is. The patient was asymptomatic and has this study, CT study for dyspnea. And there you have an encapsulated tumor with calcium in the periphery and fat inside. When the patient is lying down, you see that it has a fat fluid level, beautiful. So this fat is definitely liquid. And now, when they did a PET CT that we do now in everybody, they found a suspicious finding that there was high SUV in the wall of the tumor. And when you see that, you always think of malignancy, localized malignancy in the wall. However, the patient was operated on, and what they found is the same that we saw in the previous film. A cystic mature teratoma with area of rupture of the wall accompanied by chronic xanthogranulous inflammation, okay? So this is another case that I wanted to show you. And it is more modern, especially will help you if you do a PET CT and try not to make the wrong diagnosis. Incidentally, when you look at the CT, you see some strands there in the mediastinum. It's probably the area of invasion by the fat into the mediastinum. Very good. Final slide. Follow Dr. Pepper's advice. He knows a lot. First one, the mediastinal fat cannot be distinguished from soft tissue in the plain film and easily identified. You already knew that, but that's important. Think that you see a fat-containing tumor Actually, you have five possibilities, but the most important ones are the teratoma group, either benign or malignant. Important thing that you need, many of you didn't know, teratomas may rupture and simulate an aggressive tumor. And also, especially, do not forget epipericardial fat necrosis as a cause of acute chest pain. If you look on the internet, you will find many reports, starting for the first one that we published in 2005. And this is tiring because I don't see your faces and I feel very awkward. I'm sorry, but I will do it again, but I prefer to have the presence of the audience because I feel more motivated. Now, if you wish, you can ask any question you want, and you can do that in writing if possible, because it will be much better. And if you don't have any questions, pues, we'll finish. I'll wait for a while. Does anybody want to write any question? Nobody? It was very clear? I'm sorry. My helper is somebody's writing. Good. No. Oh, Canto. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's not a question. That's a compliment. Thank you very much. And thank you, Katarzyna. I imagine you are the one that gave the right, because I have two Katarzynas in the audience, but I hope you are the one that gave the right answer in the diploma. Thank you very much for your kindness. Anybody else? Thank you. Okay, well, that's me. Oh, yeah, that's Katarina. Okay. That's Katarina. Okay. Okay. No more. Okay. One more. They will send you. This is my first webinar. As I said, I was feeling a little bit awkward speaking alone to the computer, but I will get used to it, I imagine. And I would like to ask you if this should be repeated. Not this one, I mean, any other webinars about other subjects. If you think that I can do that again, just say yes or no. Or you left already. Okay, we will send you a questionnaire about the lecture. I think, yes, okay, well, yes, okay. Okay, well then I will repeat it, but the next time we'll charge 100 euros for that. So I'll get some money for my vacation in Menorca. Okay. Thank you very much. We stop the transmission here, if you agree, and God bless you. Bye-bye.